Welcome back to the session. In the previous session, I was giving you the intro about Lex and YARC tools, and also was explaining about the structure of the Lex program by giving an example program as well. In the program, what are the structure which needs to be used in the Lex program? And what are the sections in the Lex program that I was giving you the introduction? The Lex program has three sections, namely role section, definition section, and user subroutine section. The user subroutine section has the main function, in which the function which needs to be called is YYLex. So YYLex is a function which has to be invoked whenever the Lex analyzer is to be generated. So it performs the lexical analysis. So the main purpose of Lex tool is to perform the lexical analysis and creates the token. So output from the Lex would be the tokens. And we have the definition section, wherein the different statements like include, comment, function declaration, variable declarations would be available in the definition section. Role section has two parts. One is pattern and another one is a action. In pattern, we use the regular expression in order to match with the input. So once the pattern is matched, the action has to be taken place. So these are the different sections are used in the Lex program. So with the program, I haven't explained to you how the different sections are used and how the patterns are kept inside the role section. Now we'll discuss about how the program will be running, how to run the program. The first statement in running the program, after creating the Lex program, so you need to use in Linux environment. You need to have the compiler to run the Lex and YARC tools. we can use the VI editor to create the program, or G editor can be used to create the program. The program should be named with the extension .dl. If it is a Lex program, it should be named with the name of the program with .dl extension. So the program has to be saved with the .l extension. Once you created the program, go back to the command prompt from the terminal. You go back to the command prompt. In the command prompt, we can use some of the commands to run the program. To run the Lex program, so there are three steps we can have. In the first step, we call the Lex command. We can use the Lex command followed by the name of the program. Say the program name is example.l. As I have already told you, .l extension denotes the Lex program. So the example.l is a Lex program. So the command Lex to be used with the program name. As soon as you execute this command in the command prompt, you won't get any result, but there is a file which is generated from this command. The file is known as lex.yy.c. So lex.yy.c is the C file which is associated with example.l. So what do you mean by that one is, we use C compiler for the compilation process. Since we use the C compiler, so we have to have the .c file, that is C file, C source file we should have. In order to get the C file, when you invoke this Lex command, when you export the lex command, this will be generating the C file which is corresponding to the lex program. That is the reason if you look at the lex program file, in lex program file, most of the places you can see the C source code. The C language code, you can find it in the lex program. So whatever the statements which is written using the C code, those statements will be directly copied into the lex.yy.c. I'll just go back to the slide where part of the code will be embedded into the lex.yy.c. I will just show you. So this slide I have shown you already to mention about the skeleton of lex specification. So when you call the lex command, when you invoke the lex command, when you are giving the file name, so in this the file name is x.l. So what happens is lex.yy.c file will be generated. So in the lex.yy.c file, whatever the code which is kept inside this definition section will be copied into this file, because the definition section has the statements like the variable declaration, function declaration, comment line, and the include statement. So these statements are part of the C statements. So the same C code will be copied into the, there is no need to convert into C language because it's already a C code. So the C code will be copied into the x.yy.c file. Similarly, the main function, so whatever is there in the main function, that is also copied to the lex.yy.c. So only the difference is in the pattern, so that has to be converted into the corresponding C code. So for which we use the lex command. So what exactly the program has to do, that is there in the rule section actually. The rule section will do the process of scanning and matching the pattern and do the action. The corresponding action for each type matched pattern is done with the help of the action part in the rule section. Now I'll go back to the execution part. So once the lex.yy.c file is generated, then the next step would be, so again, we are in the command prompt. Now we have to give the command like cc followed by lex.yy.c. Once this command is given, then it will generate the executable file. So when you give the cc command, CC is meant for C compiler. So for the compilation process, as I have already mentioned that we got the C file, so we do the compilation. So in order to compile the file, we need is nothing but the C file. So lex.yy.c is already, we have the file. Now we are passing that file with the option hyphen ll. So what do you mean by ll is lex library. So why we need to use this lex library over here is, so as I was giving you about the linking process during the linking linker and loader, in those sessions I was telling you about the linking process. So it brings the routines from the library to our program file. Same way, we have certain functions which needs to be incorporated into our program. That is the reason we refer the lex library. From that, we link the function with our program. So that is the reason we use the Lex library over here. So using hyphen is meant for the option. So this is a normal notation we use in the Unix commands. So whenever you use the commands, Unix commands, so there would be a lot of options can be used with the each command. So that is optional one. If you want, you can use those options. So without the options also, there would be some commands. But some of the commands need to be given with the options. Here we are using the option, that is, we have to include the, or we have to link the library to our program. So this is what has been done in the second line. So during the compilation, it does the linking also. Once it is done, then you can get the executable file. The executable file which has the name as a.out. So a.out is the executable file which is created from the previous line. That is, after compilation, you get the executable file that is named as a.out. Now you have the executable file, so which needs to be executed. So now to run the program, what we have to do is we use the third step, that is ./a.out. So what is the use of dot is, now if you see the dot, again we are using second time dot in the, you know, in the first dot which we have used in the first program. I have shown you the Lex program, dot has been used. So that time the dot which represent the regular expression, that is a meta character actually. So here, that is inside the program we use. So inside the program, in the role section, we use the meta character to match the pattern. But here the dot has, you know, it is different meaning. it has different meaning. So this dot in the command prompt is representing the current directory. So there are two different notation used in the Unix environment when we when we are in the command prompt. So dot and double dot. Dot represent current directory and double dot represent parent directory. In order to switch between the directories, we can use this notation which can be used with the cd command, that is changing the directory. So changing between the directories, change from one directory to another directory, wherein we use this dot and double dot notation. So here the dot represent current directory, under the current directory, so the slash represent, so under the current directory, so in the directory we have, so directory is set as a folder, so it is mentioned as folder in Linux environment. So inside the folder we have the file a.out. So if you look at the directory, current directory, you can see the a.out file. When you use ls command in the command prompt, you can see the a.out file which is displayed when the ls command is executed. Similarly, after lex command is executed, if you could execute the ls command, you can see the lex.yy.c file over there. So now ./a.out, when you do this command, what happens? It will run the program. So now once started running the program, what the program will do, that is what we have already seen in the two programs. We have taken a two example program. In those program, when the Lex program is running, what happens with the input, what it does with the input, that we have already seen. So these are the three steps to be followed when you want to run the Lex program. Now move on to the next concept, that is symbol table. What is the purpose of the symbol table? Why do we need the symbol table? Is when you had a program in the beginning, I was showing you the program, the second program, which is used to recognize the words. In order to recognize the different words, what we did in the program is we were giving the different words. Say, for example, if you want to recognize verb, you are giving the values as the pattern as is or are. If you want to match the, or if you want to recognize the noun, you are giving something like dog, cat, male, female. If you want to recognize determiner, you are giving a or the, and so on. So whenever you would like to recognize certain words, the type of words, say it's a noun or verb or something else, so you are giving the proper patterns and you are checking with the input, and the program will be able to recognize the words, the words, type of the words, and it gives you the result. That's how you can see the result as the noun is dog, verb is, determiner the determiner a, noun is male. So such kind of output we were able to get it by recognizing the word and the type of the word in the given input. This is the program we have already discussed. But in this program, if you look at the verbs is not only is and are. There are plenty of verbs we have. So in order to keep those verbs, in order to match with those verbs, what we are supposed to do is we have to include those patterns. If you are using was as a verb, then was that has to be included in the pattern. Similarly, if I want to check for where, then that verb has to be included in the pattern. So whatever the type of word you want to match, or the particular word you want to match, then that has to be placed in the pattern. We do not know what kind of input will be given by the user. So sometimes the user will give the verb as is. Sometimes the user will give the verb as was. So each time we cannot go and change the pattern. It is not easy job. When the input is given accordingly, we cannot go and change the program. And it is not easy job to include all the verbs over here also. So if I'm having some 10 verbs, if it is a definite, this is only 10 verbs are used, then I can keep the 10 patterns. But the next time somebody can use some different verbs, that time again I need to change the pattern. So this problem occurs when you really wanted to check for some types of words, especially with respect to the noun, pronoun, verbs, adjective, adverbs, conjunctions, all these different types of words when you use, then it is very difficult to change then and there the program structure, the pattern of the program. It's not an easy job. That is where we introduce the concept of symbol table. So what you do here is you are keeping the types of words in the table, like a data structure, you keep it. And whenever you are introducing, whenever the input is given, so based on the input, so these are the words to be checked. Then that will be stored in the database. Then when the input is given, then automatically it is taken from the database and it will be matched. So it will be very easy to do this job compared with the previous case. That is why what we do is we introduce the data structure concept therein, the words and list of words, that is the words and type of words will be stored in the structure, data structure. Then whenever the input is given, which will be matched with the data structure, and that will be matched, that will be done. So that is where we are using the symbol table. So for the symbol table, we introduce the linked list concept here. Introduce the linked list for storing the words. Now if you look at this particular portion of the program, so this is definition section. We have percentage open and hash include statements we have, and enum we are using as usual in C language. We use same way we use the enum, and there is a variable lookup we use, and we made the value as 0. So we have the different types of words like verb, adjective, adverb, noun, preposition, pronoun, conjunction, all these things we use. And we have a variable called state, and we have the functions are declared here, that is add word and lookup word. So add word is meant for adding the words into the linked list, and lookup word is meant for traversing the linked list, which is nothing but searching the word from the linked list. So this function declaration and variable declaration we do in the definition section. If you look at this slide is meant for only the definition section. So this is definition section, and in the rule section, what we do is at the end of the input, we put new line. So once you see the new line, that is end of the line. So state is equal to lookup. So initially state value is 0. And it varies according to the type of word comes. Suppose if you have a word, then the state is equal to verb. So if you have a type of a word is verb, state is equal to verb. If the type of the word is adjective, the state is equal to adjective. So state is a variable which is declared already as a int data type, and according to the arrangement, according to the sequence of different types of words, the value will be assigned. Say for example, in the enum, lookup is equal to 0. Then automatically, verb will be having the value 1. Adjective will be having the value 2. So these numbers are assigned to verb, adjective, adverb, and so on. So when the state is assigned with verb, adjective, adverb, automatically the number 1 or number 2 or number 3 will be assigned to state. So state is an integer value which is taken from this enum variable. So that is what exactly happening here. So if you look at the pattern in the rule section, caret symbol followed by verb. What is the meaning of caret symbol is? The caret symbol which represent that it is matching with the beginning of the line. Suppose if the line starts with verb, then it will be matched. So that case state is equal to verb. Otherwise, if the line is starting with adjective, then the state is equal to adjective. So based on that, the state value will be keep on changing. What type of word you are giving, depending on that, the state value will be changed. And if any word is given, the word is given, so it will be checking with the state. If the state not equal to lookup, then it has to keep on adding the word. So if you found any word, then you keep adding the word into the linked list. If not, then it will be searching in the linked list and matches with the linked list values and returns whether the type of the word is whether it is a verb or adjective or adverb like that. So that is the purpose. We have two functions. One is add word and other one is a lookup word. So whenever you happen to see any word, you type the input. The input is having the word, some words, is or was or where, like that. If you find out, then it will be searching the linked list and find it out what is the type of the word. To find out the type of the word, we have the switch case wherein it will be searching the word, then it finds what is the type of the word, the case verb, case adjective, case adverb. So it will be printing whether it is a adjective or adverb or verb, that will be decided. So it's all happens when you search the word from the linked list. So here we have the structure for the linked list. So if you look at this slide, which shows the user subroutine section, and the previous slide shows the rule section. So the rule section, we have the pattern and the corresponding action. If you look at the first line, that gives you the pattern A to Z and capital A to Z, which already we discussed, and the corresponding action part, whether it has to look or whether it has to add. So this gives you the rule section. So in the rule section, we declare the linked list that has to be, the structure has to be given. So struct word and the word name and word type. So that will give you what is the word and what is the type of the word. So if the word is, then type of the word is verb. So this two information should be there in the node. That is where the collection of nodes forms the linked list. So when you keep multiple nodes, then it's forming the linked list. So each node has the type and the corresponding word. So if you look at the add word, so add word is meant for adding the content into the linked list. So what is the content? What's the content we are passing? One is type and another one is a word. So what we do, we start from the header record, then we keep adding the node in the linked list. That is what, so we are searching. We are searching the linked list, and if that is already defined, whether it is already defined or not, we have to search, then we have to add the words. So that is where we can see the adding words. So node structure has to be given. It's similar to the linked list concept, so I need not explain much about how exactly the adding process happens. It is just a simple linked list where the node is added and the word has to be searched from the linked list. So only the two parts we are having, searching and adding. So this is the add part. Left hand side will be the add part and the right hand side will be the searching part. So when you are adding the linked list, also keep on adding the linked list at the end. If you have three nodes, at the end of the third node, you will be adding the new node. So this is what keep happening. So in the add word function, you are adding the node to the linked list. If you look at the right side, that is a lookup word, which means you need to search the word. Okay, so keep searching the word till you are reaching the last node. And you have to find whether the particular word is matched with the word in the linked list. So you have a node. In the node, we have the type and word. So whatever the input you are giving, if that word is there in the node, then it matches and we will be able to know what is the type of the word. So the type of the word also will be written. So that is why if you look at the lookup word, has the return type int. So from the int will come to know what is the type. So as already we have seen that enumerator variable, whether it is a verb or adjective adverb, so it is giving the value 1, 2, 3, 4 like that. So based on the return value, we'll come to know whether it is 1 or 2 or 3 or 4 like that. So that is what happens over here. So this is exactly how we will be able to send the words to the linked list. And same way, when you are giving some values, you'll be able to match with the words and get to know what is the type of the word also. So while you are giving the input, how to give is, first of all, you have to give the input as starting with the type of the word. Let's say, for example, verb followed by is, was, where, is, like this you can give. So if you give, then these information will be stored in the database, that is data structure, linked list. So when you are giving in the next line, when you are giving some words like is, so now what it will do, it will be matching that word from the linked list. It will be searching from the linked list and it will tell you that this is word is matched and what is the type of the word. Is is verb. Like that, it will give you the information. For that purpose, we have this symbol table program. Now moving on to the next concept, that is grammar. So grammar is basically the rule which we need to follow. So it is a whenever you are giving some input, whether the input is following the rules or the grammar, then we can say the input is a valid one. So for that, we need to have some notation which needs to be used, that I will explain when we are seeing about the yak. So when yak and legs, when we combine together, whenever you write program in legs and whenever you write program in yak, so basically these two programs are meant for lexical analysis and syntactic analysis, which means the scanner and parser. So when you combine this legs and yak together, the parser will be in the higher level. So the program will be starting from the yak first, generally from yak. Then it goes on calling the legs. That's where you remember, in the main function, we have given the function name as yylegs. So the parser calls the lexer through the yylegs function. So whenever it needs a token, whenever it needs input, it has to call the yylegs function so that it will be getting the token from legs. So the legs generate tokens because performs lexical analysis. Lexical analysis is nothing but scans the entire program and recognizing the token. It is identifying the input and it generates the token. If the token is requested by the yak, then that will be returned to the parser. See, when you are sending the tokens, it is not that all the tokens are required by the parser. Some tokens would be required, some tokens may not be. So whichever the token is requested by the yak, those tokens will be returned to the parser. The remaining tokens, the parser just ignore it. So this is how the legs and parser communication takes place. So when you have certain tokens, so the token has to be defined. What are the tokens? Which are the tokens are used? Say, for example, in the previous case, we have seen that the tokens like noun, the types of the word, noun, pronoun, verb, adjective, all those things we have seen. So these are the tokens. So in order to recognize what is the type of the word, so the token has to be passed. So the token is defined in the yak. So yak defined the tokens. When it is defining the token, it assigns code for each token. That is called as token code. So each and every token has token code. So that would be there in the file called y.tab.h. .h represent header file. So in the header file, the definition of the token would be available. So when you do the communication between Lex and Yak, so when there is a communication between the Lex and Yak, when you want to combine Lex program and Yak program, so the header file y.tab.h header file has to be included in the Lex program. Why it is required is because from the Lex, the token is sent to the Yak, and Yak should know this is the token which is coming from the Lex. So both Lex and Yak should know or should understand this is a token which is passed between the Lexer and parser. That's why in the parser side, we have the definition of token with the token code. Those details should be included in the Lex as well. So when you create a Yak program, how to create Yak program? So the same way how we were using the structure for the Lex program, same way we'll be having a structure for the Yak also. So how we are going to create the Yak program, we will be discussing in the next session.